All right, it's episode 2 of Check the Mirrors, where I answer your questions, comments, stuff like that. Let's dive into it. First one up, is the best way of a fresh install of Windows through control panel recovery? Good question. I've never used that method. I'm old school. I used to use dban a long time ago, which was like an application if you were super paranoid and wanted to wipe all these sectors and make sure no one gets your data. I don't know why I did that. It just felt cool. But these days, I just use Diskpart. Diskpart is a Microsoft program. It's like within the OS. It's on the installation disk. And you go in and you just launch this thing. You make sure you select the right disk. This is critical. And make sure you kind of wipe all the partitions out of that. And you clean it. And by cleaning it, it sets all sectors to zero. There is nothing going to be left on that drive. That's my preferred method when I do a brand new fresh install. If you were to get Windows 11 installation image from their website, it's going to be 24H2. And there's actually been like forced updates, I think, on a lot of people. So if you didn't want to be on 24H2, it's too late. It's here now. All right, next question is from Thomaser54. Sorry, but your benchmark must be wrong. I'm using triple 1080p with a 13600K and a 4070 Ti. All details on max, I have 180 FPS. The 1% low was never near 144 Hertz. A friend of me is using a triple 1440p and a 12600K with a 4080. All details on high, and he has 120 FPS. Your 7800X3D is not a good CPU for LMU or R-Factor. The 3D V-Cache didn't help here, etc. So you can see a bit of my reply there. One thing to keep in mind is that, and you guys know that if you're watching this video, is the simulators are updating. Chipset drivers are updating. GeForce drivers are, everything is updating. So, you know, results from, in this case, last year, they're not gonna be present today. I did that video, I think I only had 1,000 subscribers back then, I'm not sure. So things have moved on, and if you stumble across one of my older videos, I definitely encourage you, see if I have a newer one, because things have probably changed. As for why his results are different than mine, I don't have a clue. I don't know how many cars he's drawing. I don't know what circuits he's at. I don't know what cars he's testing. I don't know anything about his testing situation. But what you can trust with me is that my testing situation is the same for all of the GPUs or CPUs that I'm testing in that benchmark run. That's critical. It has to be identical. That's the only way we can do these comparisons. So yes, you might get a higher number than what I might have because you have a different configuration. But if you were to repeat that and use different CPUs as closely as I am, I'm sure you'll find similar results. All right, next question. We've got another one from Tata51. Do you have a chance to compare the 7600X3D versus the 5800X3D? It seems to be reasonably priced. Prices would probably drop even further when the 9600X3D comes out. Might be a good option for those on a budget. So this processor might be something that a lot of you aren't familiar with because it's a limited release. I think Micro Center might be one of the only places that carries this. There might be a place in Europe, I'm not sure. I think it's because it's a poor silicon production, and maybe they don't get all the cores when they make a 7800X3D or one of the other X3D chips, so they just disable a couple, clock it a little lower, I think is what it is. I don't think it's an exclusive production run. So because of that, yeah, those lower boost clocks have me a bit hesitant to recommend it. It's usually around the same price as a 9700X. And it's a newer processor, it clocks quite a bit higher, doesn't have the X3D cache, and because samples haven't gone out for the 7600X3D, there aren't that many people who are reviewing it. I know Gamers Nexus has a review up, you can go like search it on their website or find it on their YouTube channel, and it does consistently outperform a 9700X. So, you know, it's a bit of a toss-up between it and that one. Yeah, I definitely, if you're don't buy like a used expensive 5800X3D, if you're on an AM4 platform, I think I would just commit and upgrade to AM5. You're going to want that in the long run anyway. If you have plans to do high-end GPU purchase, like a 5070 Ti or something along those lines, I think you would probably want to make that leap to the AM5 platform. All right, so next question. This one's actually from my Pimax first impressions video. This person comes through Metal CC, I guess, 219. I think you were lucky. I had two units. They all went back. I had warping, focus problems, discomfort, both units. The blooming was terrible, local dimming. I know you can tweak it. No Pimax for me. They need to fix all of this, quality control, et cetera, et cetera. And I replied to him. I said, well, you know, fair. There's lots of disgruntled people in the Pimax Discord. It's actually kind of outrageous. They don't like moderate anything on their Discord. There are people in there who are upset and about Pimax, and they just ramble on. But there's always going to be customers who have a bad experience, who something didn't work for them or whatever reason. And you can go read those reviews. Now, I'm not going to defend this one way or the other, but I mean, according to their own site, it's a minority that don't have a great experience. And from what I've seen in Discord, I don't think they're deleting reviews. I respect that approach. So I talk about other RMAs that I've had. You know, my Quest 3 has been perfect. My Index, I've RMA'd my Valve Index twice. It's down there in a box. But this other person came through and replied, and they said, he's not lucky. He's an affiliate partner. This review is basically an ad. Okay. So that's worth, I think, discussing, or at least talking about. First of all, the unit I was sent by Pimax came from an Amazon warehouse. So I know that. I saw where it originated from. I could see the tracking. So it was a production unit. There was nothing unique handpicked about it. The second thing, as far as being an affiliate partner, yes. The agreement that I have with Pimax is that I can keep this headset as long as I post a video, ideally once a month. And that's convenient for me because I want to use this and need to use a high-end VR headset for my data analysis when it comes to CPUs and GPUs. So it's kind of a beneficial relationship that I get a product that I need and has relevant results to you guys, and they get, you know, the exposure of having a Pimax on the table or on my head or in the benchmarks. And then I guess the third thing would be like affiliation. This is kind of how the whole YouTube thing works. Now, I thought my first impressions video was really on point and honest. Like, I called out the problems where I saw them and gave an authentic experience. So I'm not doing anything extra to do promotion. Now, in contrast to this, just recently, Camus, they make wheels and pedals. They've reached out to me. And they're like, hey, would you be interested in our products? Okay. Now, this discussion with them has been very much about a whole, like, you know, social media influencer thing, which I have no interest in. They want to send me their entry level model, and they want me to do 5 videos in the first month about this wheel. Like, I don't do 5 videos a month. You guys know how much time and effort it takes to do what I do. I don't have time to do 5 promotion videos. Now, with all of that said, Pimax is going to be running a discount on the Pimax Crystal Light. I think it's 10%. Actually, am I allowed to talk about this? I think I'm allowed to talk about it. They're going to do a 10% discount through a unique code, and I'll post that on my YouTube channel feed. So if you get alerts on the posts, you'll see that pop up. It's about, you know, 9 days from now or 8 days from now is the plan for that. And again, you guys get a discount. I get a kickback from them. Your kickback helps fund my wall of GPUs up there and all the work that I do. Anyway, I'm sure someone's going to call me a hypocrite. The internet, let me tell you. All right, so moving on. This is from Juan Txobim. Wow, I don't know how to say that. Great video as always. I recently upgraded my GPU from a 3080 to a 5080. Since the release of iRacing Season 2 2025, I've noticed some micro studying on the GPU. I've got quite a bit of headroom, 6 milliseconds on the GPU, 4 milliseconds on the CPU. I'm using these drivers, Windows 10. Do I have this issue? Tried OpenXR and OpenVR, Pimax Crystal Light. He's on a 7800X3D. Okay, so the reason why I've included this one is the, you know, first of all, I outline, okay, who knows what's going on? Like, I have no idea what's happening on this guy's computer. Yes, he has an issue, but it can be anything. And so I outline like a few things that I would look at and then an approach on how to analyze those two things. So if you want to read this, this is kind of like my recommendation of how you go about doing that. He then replied because he found a solution, but it's a strange one. Finally got rid of the micro stutters. Although I did a DDU NVIDIA drivers, so that's like a clean installation. He made sure the other old installation was gone. He found on Reddit that disabling digital sound from the NVIDIA card could help. That was the key. I disabled the sound going from NVIDIA to my two monitors with Windows 10 sound configuration. Huh. This is like one of those things. Don't make assumptions. Every time you don't understand something or you haven't double checked something, it could be the source of your problems. It could be very unique to your situation. So I guess he's running, I guess what I find kind of crazy is like, I don't run VR with multiple monitors. I have one monitor and the VR headset. So all of a sudden he has two monitors plugged in and the sound is getting split somehow. And that's causing a micro stutter issue. So these are things that you got to double check on your end that you can't, don't be, he went ahead and blamed, you know, an iRacing season 2 update. Maybe something in there had an influence, or maybe, you know, it was also a Windows update happened and that changed some audio file settings. Maybe his chipset drivers, maybe he hasn't updated his Realtek drivers for his, anyway, it could be so many things. So this is just kind of an example of how no one can instantly know the answer or wave a magic wand. You just have to take a lot of due diligence on your end and go through methodically to find the solution. All right, next we have Probhux, who had the comment, kindly test a 5060 Ti 16GB and the 5070 for triple screens. Ah, I see someone's targeting the $550 price range. I, at this point, just don't recommend a 5060. The 5060 Vanilla, which is now secretly finding its way into stores, a 5060 Ti 8GB, which, as you guys know, has a VRAM constraint. But even the 16GB version, it's more than just the capacity of the VRAM. It's also the bus. If you compare it to the 5070, I guess it would be, what, 128 to 192-bit bus. So that basically translates to how many memory chips there are actually physically on the board. And the wider bus means more chips, which means more opportunity to read-write. Therefore, even though the 5060 Ti has a higher capacity, the 5070 can write and read faster than it has, or at a larger amount, because it has more bandwidth. I mean, I was looking at PC Part Picker, and they were listing like $480, more likely $500 for a 5060 Ti. That doesn't make sense to me. And then, I mean, the 5070 12 gig is supposed to be $550, I think, and you can find them, you know, around that $600 mark or just above that $600 mark. So, you know, again, it's not in simulators, but there is lots of examples of performance measurements out there. And even if the 5070 is an increase in price of, say, 25%, at single 4K resolutions in GPU heavy games, like a lot of these two single screen games are, it's like 40% faster than a 5060 Ti. So like, why you just don't buy it? Don't buy a 5060 Ti 16GB if you think it's just not. I can't see it being faster at triple screens. So if you're in that price range, like 56 or 5070 all day, like go for that one for sure. All right, so we've got a super thanks and a question from Little Rhino. Thank you very much. And the question is, iRacing is supposed to be giving us a new render engine soon. 2026 seems even close by iRacing timeline standards, but we'll see. I would love to see a ranked list of graphical options and how they would impact the CPU and GPU headroom. And this is the real main question, what's going on here. He has one for the Quest 3, but we answered that in the comments, I think. Wouldn't that be nice to understand the direct impact of each graphical setting, that if you enable shadow maps, if you increase MSA to 2x to 4x, if you go like, you know, the grandstands and the crowd and all that from high, medium, low, you know, what performance impact will we see with that? And what's tricky about, there's like two main things that complicate that. And one thing is inherent within iRacing, and that is the different quality and complexity to which all of the assets are rendered and have been built within the engine. So last year, I had done a comparison between the 7900 XTX and the 4080 Super, which at the time were two of the fastest cards, and they are still very quick. However, I showed them by track at triple 1440p. I'll put that up on the screen here. And what was kind of wild to see is, depending on the race discipline and the number of cars and just the test scenario, the FPS is just hugely different between the cars as you go from track to track. So, you know, that just shows you how you can analyze these graphical components, but depending on a whole bunch of just race scenario components, you're going to see different results. At least that would be what I would expect. Another complexity is going to be, if I, you know, what card do I do that comparison on where I go through all those graphical settings? If I use, like, I don't know, like imagine a 5090 and I did that, it has so much GPU headroom that we're talking about fractions of milliseconds that would change. But if we're already burdened, say with a 3060 Ti, a car that's already overwhelmed at a resolution, that adding these things, manipulating each one of those values could probably have a big impact on what its overall performance is. And then you can't, like, and then what are the other settings? So if we're analyzing MSAA, what do I select for all the other settings? Are they maxed or are they medium? Are they high? What, because the combination of what else is being rendered or what other graphical effects are applied, that's going to influence, I would assume, you know, that one variable I am changing. So it's a can of worms, man. I don't know how to produce results that wouldn't be misleading. And I'm sure other YouTubers, I mean, I've seen these other videos and people talk about their optimization guides for iRacing and they don't even show once a bar chart. And I'm like, well, then where's the data? So anyway, I'm on the other side. I'm just like, oh my God, there's so many variables. There's so much data. How could we make any sense of it if we tried? So I guess that's kind of where I'm at. So I would look forward to hearing, you know, your comments and ideas about how to move forward with implementing an idea like that. And yes, I have seen all of the requests to get a 5090. Listen, I want one too. It would make a Pimax just really shine. I've kind of explored the opportunity to maybe rent one from someone in town. There's some liability concerns, and it's also buggy with a lot of different titles and with all the NVIDIA drivers that we've seen. So it can actually get fairly expensive pretty quickly just to try and, like, you know, casually rent one. So yeah, they're still very much unobtainable, very much expensive. So this is a great segue to, hey, if you can buy me a coffee, I would appreciate it, because then it can go into that 5090 fund or my Patreon or Super Thanks or something like that. And once again, I want to thank all my supporters that have got me this far. So let's keep going. Thanks for watching.